How the response to this film differs today from years ago? Well, that I can't. This is the only audience I've seen it with in 20-something years, so I can't really fairly answer that. But I can say that when I did make the film, I was very scared. I was very nervous about me, a guy as in my 30s already, and I'm making a movie about a young girl, a tween, like she's 11 years old or so, and I was worried about how women would respond to the film, because who am I to understand what that experience is about? But I also feel philosophically that's my job as a filmmaker, is to make leaps and to imagine other ways of being and experience. While in some sense, you know, people always ask me, is it, well, it's autobiographical and so forth. I always say, yes, everything's autobiographical, although nothing, in fact, actually happened. You can't take it literally. Everything's so oblique. Not simply the sex of the protagonist being different. At that time, I was anxious about how women might respond to it. I guess I took that risk, that I believed that even though, just because a character does something that we don't maybe think is the right thing to do, doesn't mean it's not true to the integrity of that particular character. And so I try to always be true to these characters that I've devised here. And when, of course, he says, 3 o'clock, you get raped, meet me there, and she shows up, one could, of course, say, no, of course you don't show up. Why, that's terrible. That doesn't make sense. But to me, psychologically, given the circumstances of who this girl was and her life at that time, it did make a kind of sense to me. It did make perfect sense that she would meet. You know, one of the titles that I had thought of using for the film was Faggots and Retards, and I knew I couldn't use that since it wouldn't be printed, you know, in a newspaper. But the idea being that this is the currency that these kids use, and they have an understanding of what all these words mean, but certainly not the way in which adults understand them, the resonance, the ramifications, and so forth. So I always tried to be true to who they were, even as I might disapprove, let's say, of their behavior and so forth. It for me, the rule was just that it had to be true to the integrity of these characters.
Your perspective on that world of adolescence that you depicted. Do you have a background that sort of,
a background in persecution? a life of persecution. Look, I am, of course, shaped and limited to some extent by my life experience and observation. And I think at the inception of this film, I definitely was thinking it was a kind of antidote for me to a very popular show at the time called The Wonder Years, which was it was basked in a kind of nostalgia that didn't sit well with me. And so it was a kind of a counter to that in some sense, not for the sake of saying, oh, things are bad, because I think the irony here is that for all of the horribleness that transpires here, there is also great tenderness, that what moves me is the way in which this marriage of the, let's say, the ugly and the beautiful, the way that that we can take this very ugly word Kant and turn it into a kind of poetry, a kind of lyricism, when the young girl says, "I don't mean to be a cunt," and we're moved by that. I am. That there's a kind of poignancy in that in the way in which this language is being used, and this kiss that happens. I mean, in fact, it's not only the character's first kiss; it's the girl, the actress's first kiss, and it's the possibility of that, of these connections, of this tenderness, is what that ultimately is what moves us. So it's you know, whether you the ugly, the beautiful, the sacred, the profane, there's always a kind of friction, let's say, between, you know, that I have an something from a Greek operatic kind of work going against what is going to be an ostensible rape, you know, but rape, it's not even entirely clear that even the characters understand what that word even really means. So, of course, there are the literal facts of my personal experience, but if it were just that, it would be a different, if I were to do an autobiographical film, it would be a very different film, a very different kind of nightmare. And I think in some way it's one of the first things, switching genders there, and I actually went to a very preppy sort of school. I didn't go to a public school. Is that by transforming that experience into something else, it freed me up to invent and scenarios that could dramatize something of the nature of the character's life.
When you watch films, old or new today, what do you gravitate towards? Like, what are some films you watching recently, or do you like to pick films out for your kids to watch?
I do have two little ones who are watching this movie for the first time tonight. It's true. They are different characters, and while all my other films, I have told them they have to wait till they're 35. given that they've seen, let's say, the films such as Mean Girls or Eighth Grade, and that this sort of mini genre, let's say. That I felt varying degrees that they were ready for this film in some way, just by virtue of weighing that versus having to wait till they're 18, I think even 6 months ago, I said, you know, I'll let you see it once it's on a big screen, assuming that would be another 5 years before that would happen. But I happened to be invited this holiday, and so they're seeing it now. They've seen, let's say, quote, worse, but I hope I'll find out in years to come what damage I have wrought. I think I forgot. You had some question. I don't know if I touched.
Personally, what films do you like?
What do I like?
Yeah,
I mean, I love
old, new, whatever.
I watch lots of things, but these days I don't have a lot of free time. Unfortunately, I am just like at home with like the little ones, and in the evening, so I only get the daytime. I don't have much of a life, basically. But it's the same kinds of art movies that you guys probably go to, or weird underground things, you know, that aren't playing at the multiplex. So I'm not trying to be evasive, but the fact is, if I don't write it down, I don't have the list ready at hand. Someone else? Yes.
Well, what were some of your influences for this movie?
I'm trying to remember, what was I thinking? You know, it's funny that you ask that question, because for almost every other movie, I can tell you immediately what movies I'm referencing. I can tell you one interesting story here that will give you one example. When we were location scouting, there was a scene in the script where Brandon corners Dawn in what was described as a shadowy stairwell. And when we went location scouting, we were lucky, we found this particular public school that would be available to us. The first thing I had to figure out was, how do I solve the problem, because there is no shadowy stairwell. It was really brilliantly designed. The architect understood that it would be impossible for a bully to corner anyone in this school, because they were all just open hallways. There were no corners to go in and get away with this kind of behavior. So it was kind of bully-proofed. And I was kind of in awe of that, this sense of design that the architect had. So what I did was I moved it outside, and he threatens her there against the wall of the school. And the reason I moved it outside, because I was thinking, I know this is oblique, but I was thinking about North by Northwest and the cornfield scene where Cary Grant is running away from the plane and all. And because that is all about, that was his, in fact, statement about how to create suspense instead of the, let's say, the cliche of the shadow, play of shadow and corners. Here is light and space, okay? So I brought it outside on a beautiful day, and while he's there threatening her, I had put a soccer match going on in the background at the same time, so that it could communicate in some sense, let's say, the obliviousness of the world and sort of the happy world that's going on while this intense threat is taking place. And so that came out of, I immediately thought of Hitchcock at that moment, okay? But it's the more you see, the more you have to pull on as a library while you're working and while you're conceiving of projects. There's some.
I'd be very curious to hear your thoughts about the lay of the land in indie film currently for these very interesting and layered and complicated, you know, narrative character pieces that are quirky and unusual and sometimes a bit challenging. That arc seems to have changed over the last 10, 20 years in indie film and the receptivity and the reach of these films. What's your sense of how that landscape has changed over the decades since you made this film?
I think I don't want to just spout the cliches that I read in cultural critiques, you know. It's true that I think a movie, I don't even know that a movie like this would get made today. I just don't know. I do believe that one of the inventions that has happened over the last 20 odd years is this technology that makes filmmaking economically viable in ways it never was before. Therefore, that many more aspiring filmmakers can create really unexpected work, okay, let's say. So there's a lot more work, and on the good side, that raises the bar. It's not enough to say, well, I made a feature and it'll only cost $10,000. That's simply not enough. It actually has to be good, you know, and not only good. And good is not enough. In some sense, it has to feel fresh. It has to speak to the moment. That's not something you can anticipate. You can't compose a movie knowing it's going to hit a cultural moment. There's a year or so that passes, and things are always changing, and there's a kind of alchemy that takes place that you cannot anticipate, you cannot predict. If you could know it, a lot of movies would be more successful than they are. They kind of hit the, they miss the mark, so to speak, and being a little bit outdated or seeing too far ahead in some way. I think there's always something. Every year there are interesting films that do get made. The problem is, people, unlike you guys, they don't go. You know that while the studio system is thriving in spite of the lack of attendance at some of these many of these theaters, they thrive because they have so much marketing and merchandising and streaming and ancillary markets, let's say, that insulate them. The independent filmmaker has a much harder time of it because fewer people go to the movies. Fewer people who go to these kinds of movies are going to these movies. I teach at a film school at NYU, and these are grad students, and they watch on their laptops or on their iPads. They very seldom go out to the movie theater. And if they're not going, that spells trouble, you know. And that's what, it makes it, the people who are hit hardest and hit first are those most vulnerable, which are those outside of the studio system. So I'm not grim about things, you know. There are pluses and minuses, and there's always interesting work every year that comes out of left field. You know, it doesn't have to come from New York or LA. You know, it can come from anywhere. It really can, and I do believe that. It's keeping this sense of the movie-going experience alive, because it is very different, a communal experience like this in the dark room with the projection like that is very different from being at home or on the go watching it on an iPad or an iPhone or some other such device.
I have a question sort of about three of your films. That would be, I'm wondering if you can help me with the timeline of what happens to Dawn in Pound Drones and then also in Wiener Dog, and see, you mind talking about that a little bit?
Well, I play loosely with timeline. I'm not so rigid about that, Dawn actually doesn't appear. Her brother Mark does in Palindromes. I actually had spoken to Heather, but at that point she was not open to reprising the character. And then Greta Gerwig played her as an adult in Wiener Dog, which is, of course, a reference to what we just saw. I sometimes bring back characters from movies that I've made. And it's not a calculated thing. It's just a kind of, it's handy. I'm somewhat, I like to play. Not everyone wants to play with me. Okay, I can say the one I'm planning to shoot, that I was supposed to shoot last year, but I'm hoping to shoot next year, is does not incorporate anyone from any of these movies.
First, I want to say thank you for this movie, because I'm a really big Dawn Wiener fan, and I feel very close to her.
Thank you.
Partially because I had that happy face T-shirt. She wears, and the first time I saw the movie, I couldn't believe that it was in a movie. I think it was from Kmart. And I was 11 in 1989. And when I watched the movie, because I know the movie came out in 1995, and to me, it's like exactly my timing and my life almost. but I'm wondering when you see the movie set exactly, because there's this sort of wonderful sort of like 70s house with these '80s, like the Debbie Gibson is like mid-'80s, and then this T-shirt I know could have been purchased in about 1989, and then there's this.
Yeah, well, I think that my sense was that if you're setting it, it was set in 94, but the idea was that they'd been living in that house for a while and so wouldn't have bought furniture from 1994, that it would be more dated, and that that Debbie Gibson was still something that would play on the radio at that point.
Really?
Yes, yes, there was grunge, and then there was also another side of stuff going on. You were a lot cooler. Anyone? No? Yeah. Oh.
I'm curious about your relationship with comedy and your writing, and that you bounce back and forth from the absurd and things that we, a lot of your audience, I'm sure, somewhere in the middle there comes up something funny, and how intentional is that? How organic do you think that is?
Yeah, you know, it's why I've always had, in some sense, always a very divided response. Oftentimes half the audience laughs and tell me how funny it is, and then the other half is angry at the first half, like, how can you laugh? This is so sad. This is so sorrowful and painful. For me, it has always been both concurrently in play with each other. The comedy that is built into the pathos. These are sad comedies. It's right there on the page. Things that elicit different, sometimes opposing kinds of emotional responses. But they are always deeply emotional for me. I wouldn't go to the trouble, the pain of making a film, did I not have a strong emotional experience in writing this. It's too hard to make a movie if you don't have that kind of connection to your material. But there is a sense, let's say, of irony at play here. I think oftentimes, when an actor tries, you know, the danger is when an actor sees how funny the script is, that they try to make it funny, because that's always kind of doomed. It's about grounding it as best I can in emotional truth, and leave the irony to me.
Backing on that, you're working with child actors who, and your script is very adult, and you know, a lot of stuff. So, like, how do you convey to them, sort of like, how to deliver these lines so that it kind of subverts their childishness?
Children are different. Just grown-ups are different. You know, you have to adapt to the particularities of each actor. You know, I can tell you. Heather was a gifted actress, and so with her it was a question of modifying, just like bring it down a little less, you know, or I need to emphasize something, make a point. I could trust her to understand what was going on here. The little sister, my worry with her, for example, she was only 6 months in the country, and I was worried. Because she had a Ukrainian, she's from Ukraine, she had an accent. But when I auditioned her, because she had the right look, the right quality, but I was worried about her voice. So what I did was I played a game with her where to see if she could mimic me. And that's what she did. She was a beautiful mimic. So the camera's rolling, I'm giving her the line reading, and she mimics it right back. We just cut me out.
I noticed you you mentioned this is the first time you've watched this in 20 years. So seeing it after all this time, what was sort of your strongest reaction to watching it again after 2 decades?
You know,
or
it's,
what worked or what, you know.
Look, I was just thinking about my kids, but that's really where my head was. But But I, look, it's also the funny thing is, it's every movie, if you love a movie, you overlook its flaws, and if you don't like a movie, you cannot see what's good about it, okay? It's a sort of truism, I think, for all of us. You know, if you don't like something, nothing can make you see anything good about it. Looking at it, I can say that I was a younger person, and if I had, let's say, the same script today, and I'd never made a film before, it would be a different movie, and I would approach it a little bit differently. I think it, whatever flaws that come to mind, you know, that's part of where I was at that point in my life, and I think it doesn't, they don't get in the way, let's say, of the, I think, the emotional experience of being able to connect to this world of characters.
Would you be open to doing like a TV, like a streaming series or something, like a limited, like 12 part, 8 part, whatever? Like
12, not 8. I'm teasing you. It's funny because they wanted to make this into a TV show years ago, I was fine about that. Because I just thought it would be neutered and silly and pointless, but was not going to. For me, it didn't bother me because nothing was going to change this movie. So if it became something really silly and embarrassing, I wouldn't really care. I was just sort of intrigued by the idea of how they could kitschify it or make it really banal. It ultimately didn't happen. It's a long story, not worth going into. And I know that for 20 years, different people, a lot of Broadway people have talked about turning into a musical, but it's a really bit of a challenge, I think, because once they remember that there's like 3 o'clock, you get raped, and it's like 11-year-olds, and it's Broadway, it's just not gonna happen, you know? So, a lot of people I've spoken to about this, and that's fine. I don't really care if it becomes something else or not.
But I didn't mean like even specifically this, but just in general. Just, you know, like nowadays, yeah. Like a lot of like these streaming services are throwing money at like or tour directors to be like, make your vision and standards for
Yeah, that's what you read. It's not really like that. It's not really like that. But I have flirted and I'm open to it, but my mind and heart is not focused on that. I could pursue that, but I am much more absorbed by what I do in movies, which is a kind of now almost an antiquated, anachronistic opera-like form at this point. But that's where my head and heart are. I don't say no to TV, I just am not focused on it. And the door is open if I really want to do something there. And the irony is that I actually think I'm more suited to TV than to movies to the extent that I grew up on TV. Meaning I as a kid, I watched 6 hours, 8 hours a day, I don't know, I mean, that's what I was, that was my, it wasn't like sitting reading Charles Dickens, you know. I had a very kind of middle class suburban kind of a normal childhood kind of background. So in some sense I feel I get it and I feel like I'm suited for it, but I for whatever reason it just hasn't happened.
I have kind of a weird question, but it's something that I've had since I first saw this movie 15 years ago. Was the head wound on Brandon's character, is that real?
The head wound?
The head wound?
Oh, They did a good job then.
So what? It's fake?
It's fake.
Oh,
it's
okay.
Fake.
I've always wondered that.
Yeah, it is fake. And I guess we had a good person doing that. Because that's one, you know, I always tell my students, listen, you give someone any kind of cut or wound or a blemish for an actor, you better have the money to pay a good makeup person, because if it doesn't look good, it looks embarrassing, you know?
Todd, can you talk a little bit about the project you did last year when you directed, wrote and directed some theater, and how that came about and your experience with that?
Yeah, I did. I was supposed to shoot this movie last year that, whatever, we didn't get quite enough money. It was going to be with Penelope Cruz and in Spain, and it just became too big, too much. And so when that wasn't working out, I wrote a play. We put it on in a little theater in Manhattan downtown, and it's different theater. I mean, the people are nice, but they're not as cool as film people. It has, you know, film is, I was telling Jim, I mean, film for me is so stressful. It's really, it's gonna kill me, you know. Every movie is so hard. And production really is just, you know, I always say that's my obituary, Mr. Solondz collapsed the third day of production, you know. But whereas theater, the hours are better. It was much more manageable. I wrote and directed, and one of the differences in movies, I have these auditions that are involved, and that's where I figure that's my rehearsal. It's my audition period, because then when it comes time to shooting, we don't have money. There's never a budget for rehearsal. So then when I meet them on set, we've already spent this time in the audition and we do it right there. We figure it out. Whereas in theater, actors like to really talk a lot and talk and explain and talk about the history of the character, things that I never like to do. But they listen to me, and they just accepted that. I said, okay, day one, let's just go to work, and they're used to sitting around talking about the play for a week. But I like to just go to work. That's my thing. I think in part maybe rehearsal thing with, maybe there's a fear of rehearsal because I'm afraid, like, if the more they get to know me, the less they'll be intimidated. And in order to retain whatever power I have, I have to give them no time to figure me out, to figure out how little I know. The movie premiered at Toronto in 95, and it changed my life. I know people always say you learn from failure, but success, I learned a lot more from. It's much, much more instructive and more fun. And it changed my life in a good way. It made things possible and that are not so possible when you don't have success. So I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful that I've been able to continue in this quasi-career making movies that continue to be unprofitable and lose money more and more. And I'm grateful for every investor who's made that leap in me and hope they continue to do that. I really was touched that everybody came out. Like, I'm sort of shocked. It's great that, you know, people really come out for something like this. This is so nice. So I thank Jim and everybody here for